Hey guys, welcome back. Welcome to the part 2 of how to give feedback. Do remember that we also covered part 1, and for people who have missed out on the part 1, just to summarize for you guys, in the part 1 we discussed even before you start a feedback session, what are the things that you should remember and what are the things that you should keep at the back of your mind. The first thing is, what's the reason of giving a feedback? What's the intention of providing a feedback? What will happen if we do not give feedback? So intent matters. And then we also discussed about what are the laws of feedback, right? What are the absolute few essentials that we should try to follow 80 to 90% of our time, when we provide feedback, or when we at least think of giving a feedback. And if you follow the laws of feedback 80 to 90% of the time, you will be able to make your feedback sessions more meaningful and more impactful. Just to remind you guys that in the first part, we discussed about a very disturbing stats. And that is, as per the Gallup survey, 83% of our current generation of workforce believe feedback given by the managers are not meaningful. Now, this poses a never seen challenge for the new generation of managers. When I became a manager for the first time, I never faced this challenge, and I'm sure my managers never faced this challenge. Now, this is a generational challenge, right? We are having a workforce of millennials and centennials coming in, and in the next 10 to 20 years, pretty much you will have, a 70 to 80% occupancy of millennials and centennials in our offices. So the current generation of managers are already starting up with a immense challenge, where people are saying, 80% people are saying that feedback delivered are not meaningful. So the main challenge is for us to understand the importance of the intent of feedback, right? If your intention is not there, if your intention is not to better the performance of your team members, if your intention is not to help your team members perform better, or maybe, realize his mistakes or improve on his behavior or attitude. If your intention is not proper, does not matter even if you exhibit great skill set, during feedback sessions. It does not matter. That's where a lot of people say feedbacks are not meaningful. Everything was correct. The tone of the voice was correct. The ambience was correct. Feedback was given properly, voice was not raised, but it's not meaningful, right? And that's because we are compromising on the intention. Sometimes managers provide feedback just to tick that to-do list that this month I have completed the feedback. So feedback for the sake of giving feedback, these are seen through by people, because we are all human beings. You are a human being. I'm also a human being. Managers are humans, employees are humans, customers are humans, shareholders are humans, everybody are human being, and we're all connected in a subconscious way. We can sense each other, we can sense danger, we can sense safety, we can sense happiness. We have senses, and so if you are not, your intention is not honest regarding providing feedback to better your team members' performance or to better your team members' behavior, that would be seen through eventually, in a period of time by your team members. And that's where, irrespective of whatever skill set you exhibit during the feedback sessions, it will not be touching them. It will not make them feel that these are customized feedback for them and it is meaningful to them. So I like to divide this into four categories. Category number one is when your intention is good, but your feedback skills are bad. In this case, you will still be able to make a good manager, right? So there will be at times when you will lose your cool, or your choice of words will not be there. You might not behave well at times with people because they have committed a grave mistake. So even if your skill sets are not there, but your intention is there, that intention is to better the performance of the employee, help the employee realize the mistake, and help the employee progress in his career. If your intention is there, it would be eventually seen through by the people that how hard you're working behind them, right? And so you will be able to touch those people emotionally, right? That your manager actually, you know, wants them to improve their performance and do good in their career. It will be eventually touching them personally, touching them emotionally, just like how your parents have touched you. Your parents are not good to you all the time, right? Your parents also scold you, but you eventually know that they love you and they will do anything for you when you're in trouble. It's the same way, you know, realization kicks in when your intention is correct. So if your intention is correct, but your feedback skills are not there, you'll still be able to make some impact and eventually become a good manager, provided that you, you know, when you give feedback, you keep bettering your feedback skills. Condition number two is when your intention is good and your feedback skills are also good, then you will make an awesome manager, right? No doubt about it. Condition number three, when your intention is bad and your feedback skills are also bad, you'll make an awful manager. So you need to start learning about not only feedback skills, but you also need to do some self-assessment whether you want this management job or not. Management job at the end of the day, other than your directing and controlling stuff, it's also about taking care of people. That's basically the core of management and leadership, taking care of people. Condition number three, when your intention is bad, but your feedback skills are good. In this case, what can happen is you might experience some short-term success. You might be able to impress some of your people in the way you dress, in the way you talk, in the poise exhibited by you, the self-regulation you have. You might be able to impress some of your team members. But if your intention is just to you know, provide feedback, just to have a, you know, to-do list checked, and when your team members are in trouble, you stick to the rules, you stick to the policies of the company, and you do not you know, go and help the employees, eventually these would be seen through by your team members, and that short-term impression will cease to exist. So chances are you might you know, taste some short-term success, but in the long term, you might not be able to make a good manager, you know, and forget about being a good leader. You might not be able to make a good manager. So I try to divide these things into four conditions, right? And it's up to you which condition you will fit in, or which condition you would want yourself to be fit in. All right, so I think we pretty much understand the importance of the intention of providing a feedback. So let's get started with this video, where we are going to talk about that during your feedback sessions, not before or after, during your feedback sessions, what are the things that you can follow to make your feedback even more impactful and meaningful for your employees. So with practice, you'll be able to better all these skill sets. So gather some courage to talk to people when you become a first-time manager, or even if you're a manager for the last 1 or 2 years and you're not giving enough feedbacks. Do remember, feedback skills can only improve if you provide more and more feedback. So practice makes perfect. You will not be able to follow all these skills straight away. You will only become good at providing feedback, and you know with more and more practice. The more feedback you provide, the better you become, right? So do not shy away from providing feedback, thinking that it would be a negative feedback, and I don't know how the employee will you know, take it, whether the employee will resign thinking that my manager does not like me. Do not think of all those negative things. There are studies and surveys that reveal that employees who get negative feedback are at least more engaged than the employees who do not receive feedback at all. So you do not need to think about all these negative things, right? Gather some courage and start giving feedbacks. So enough of talking, let's move to the screen and start learning. Happy learning.
Welcome to the Art of Giving Feedback Part 2. In the previous session, if you remember, we did discuss about to begin with the end in mind, what should be the intent of providing feedback. And also we discussed upon the laws of feedback. But in this particular video, we are going to provide you some tips and tricks of providing constructive feedback. So let's get started. Let's start with the basics, how to give feedback. I would want to start with negative feedback because I believe it's the negative feedback which keeps managers, you know, awake at night, right? A lot of managers are thinking so much about whether I should tell this or not tell this, whether I should sit with the employee, talk about this issue that I've observed or not. I don't know how will the employee react. All these contradictions that appears in or that happens in manager's mind is mostly around negative feedbacks. So we are going to target negative feedback first. So if a feedback is negative, then try as much as possible to give that feedback at the end of the day, before the employee closes for the day. Since post receiving a criticism, it is very difficult for an employee to work or interact with colleagues or to focus in work. And there is no time to reflect upon the feedback wherein the understanding and realization kicks in. So as much as possible, try to make sure the negative feedback should be given end of the day so that after the feedback session is over, the employee can move back home. So while traveling or after reaching home, the employee can spend some time all by himself or herself thinking about what went wrong and what he can do or she can do to come out of that performance. Since people are defensive to criticism, always start with positive points. This will make the employee feel good about himself or herself and make him open up for the difficult conversation later on. The main challenge is always to make employees realize the mistakes, right? Not only understand, but realize their mistakes and area of improvement. So just let me expand this a bit. A lot of you might be thinking why I'm emphasizing too much on realization rather than understanding. Understanding is basically part of your the neocortex, the outer brain, right? It's the logical, rational thinking brain. So understanding is part of it. So when you learn something, when you get trained on something, when you analyze something rationally, when you see a data and your eye starts moving and your head starts analyzing, it's all happening in the rational section of the brain, the neocortex. However, true change in a person, whether it's a behavior, mostly behavior, but also to some extent on performance, true change in a person comes in when he not only understands the subject, but also realize the inner content or realize the deep meaning of that. So particularly behavior, if you want to change the behavior of an employee through feedback, then you need to understand that simply by telling an employee that I saw you doing this, or I think you should do that. Simply by giving employee instruction that this is the policy, you should abide by the policy. Simply by giving those instruction, you can trigger the understanding part of it. However, unless the employee realizes his mistake, he will not make a genuine effort to correct his behavior. So the important part is make the employee realize his mistakes and the area of improvement. Then only he will truly put in an effort to improve that part, right? And change will start coming in. But understanding is a very short process. So you can provide a feedback, you can make somebody understand with your logical reasoning. But realization is a longer process. And realization takes time, takes time of reflection, it takes time of experience, takes a lot of time to come to a realization about something and then you change. So the true challenge is to make employee realize their area of improvement and mistakes rather than only emphasizing, showing them data and make them rationally believe that their performance is poor, they need to work on them or their behavior is not up to the code of conduct. The other part is whenever you are giving negative feedback, it's basically a criticism that one gets, right? Because either on his performance or on his behavior. So it's a criticism. And often it's a very human thing that whenever a human being receives criticism, the first approach is defensive. So whenever somebody attacks you, instinctively you put up your hands, either to save yourself or to fight, right? The flight or fight response. So that's that's your instinctive reaction, because that's coming from your reptilian part of the brain, the flight or fight syndrome. So whenever you attack an employee or criticize somebody, the always the first instinct is to be defensive, right? So the moment an employee put his arms up, then it would be very difficult for you to penetrate those closed arms and land your punch on the face, right? I don't mean literally land your punch on the face. That's not the point, but you get it. So when you know that a difficult conversation is about to happen and you're going to talk about a very unpleasant thing, a criticism of the employee or negative feedback, you know that that's coming in. It's always better to start with the positive feedback about the employee. What are the things that you have observed that the employee is doing very well? And whenever anybody gets a praise from someone, everybody feels good about it, right? Maybe woman feels better than men, but men also feels good about it, right? So the point is to start with the positive points, right? Every employee will have positives and negatives. It's on a relative scale, but you will find definitely positive points. Start with positive points. The moment you start with positive points, you shower your praise on the employee for his good work, then automatically the employee calms down and he's less defensive now, right? And that's the time that you should utilize to put in the important point which you intend to put in. The intention is not manipulation. The intention is to make the employee relaxed, calm, so that he can listen to the criticism with an open mind. If he does listen to his criticism with an open mind, chances are that he will realize his mistakes and he will try to correct those either performance or behavior. Keep these two things in mind. Show respect to the person's opinion and practice some diplomacy. If a person is wrong, listen patiently to all he has to say. Then begin by saying either, well, I was thinking from another point of view, or maybe you can say, well, I thought otherwise. Instead of saying, no, you're completely wrong. I'll tell you what's correct. Yeah, I'll tell you what has happened. No, don't take that approach, because again, when you attack a person directly, he will again become defensive. So whatever you're going to say after that, you know, the employee might not penetrate in the employee's mind, right? So the important thing is whatever you're saying needs to penetrate in the employee's deeper mind. And if you want to do that, then do not contradict or argue with an employee. So when you know that the employee has done something wrong and he's just putting up a defense, listen patiently to all he has to say and then begin by saying that, well, I thought otherwise. Or maybe you can also say, I may be wrong and sometimes I am wrong. And if I am, then I would want to be put right by you. Let's see my point of view here as well. So start the conversation in that way. It will definitely open up the employee. The employee would be more ready to absorb the bad news or the criticism. This is just an expansion to the previous slide that do not engage in an argument that I was saying you before. When you lose an argument, you lose. When you win an argument, you also lose. And let me try to make this a bit more clear if some of you are a bit confused. Argument is a form of a debate. You typically know how debate work. There's a topic and there are two or more sides. Let's, for an example, consider two sides. One side will talk for the topic and one side will talk against the topic. And both the side will argue and debate with each other and try to see, who will win, right? There's a stipulated time. There's a host who is keeping the time, giving equal opportunity for both the sides to speak up. And at the end of the debate or an argument, one party wins. And if no party wins in a war or argument or debate, then you have to kill one person or murder one person. Then only it stops, right? So all fighting, argument, debate can only stop if one person loses or one person is dead, right? Otherwise, it keeps going on. So argument is never good. So do not engage in argument. Now, what happens if you win an argument or if you win a debate? What happens then? If you're on the winning side, you have won the debate. You might get the prize. However, you have not truly won because you are fighting for the topic and your opponent was fighting against the topic. Now, maybe through some good examples or rational samples that you have been able to present, or maybe you have been able to articulate certain things better than your opponent. That's why your opponent lost, right? Maybe you did all those things correct, or maybe you were you know, supporting the right cause. Maybe, but the issue is that you are truly a winner if you would have convinced your opponent that you were right. But in an argument, when somebody wins, or in a debate when somebody wins after a series of shouting and arguing against each other, how many times you have seen you have been able to truly convince your opponent that you were right? Hardly any time, right? And rather, the starting point when the debate, when the debate starts, the position that your opponent took before the debate, that is, I will talk against the topic, and after losing the debate, what is the state of mind of your opponent after losing the debate? Is the state of mind something weaker than the starting point, or is the state of mind stronger right now, more convincing that he was actually correct just because the speaker or the host did not give fair amount of time, or just because he could not articulate things in a proper way and you did, you won and I lost, but I know that I was debating for the right cause, I was arguing for the right cause. So the starting point of the debate, the state of mind wherever that opponent was, and the end of the debate when the opponent has lost, it has been amplified. So now your opponent believes more in that topic, right? And on top of that, he does not have any goodwill on you, right? So at the end of the day, in front of people, you might have won the debate or the argument, but actually you have lost. And of course, you have lost the debate, you have already lost. So that's why it says that when you win an argument, you also lose. And when you lose an argument, you of course lose. And this was also articulated very beautifully by Sir Benjamin Franklin, who said, if you argue, wrangle, and contradict, you may achieve a victory sometime, but that would be a very that would be an empty victory, because you will never gain your opponent's goodwill. So all in all, the point is that when you are providing feedback to an employee, and you're, let's say you're providing some negative feedback, and although you're trying to you know, you're providing feedback with all the right intentions, you're trying to play all your cards correctly, but a lot of time things can go wrong, right? A lot of times an employee might react to the negative feedback. You might be given certain other opinions about your observation. Certain other things might come into the conversation which you never predicted, and you might see that the whole conversation is going to a different direction, and you know, you are arguing with the employees arguing with you. It's basically not a, you know, good idea to continue that feedback session. Always remember that nothing is hard and fast, right? So whenever you approach with plan A and the plan A fails, you should always have a plan B, right? And the plan B in this case would be to drop out of that conversation. Yeah, don't continue that feedback session, drop out of that conversation. Let the employee know that you might have to think about this analysis or research that he has done on you. You might have to sit on that once again, and you will get back to him. Take some time off and maybe meet the employee after a day or two when the situation has calmed down a bit. Do not provide feedback for the sake of providing feedback. Intent of providing feedback is to bring in a change in the way of working or in the behavior of an employee, or to make the employee feel good about himself and proud about himself of what he has been able to achieve. That's the intent of feedback. And if you see that through argument intent is getting hurt, then draw out of that feedback and try to engage with the employee later on. Always welcome disagreements. Do not lose temper and distrust your first instinct. Distrusting your first instinct is also a fundamental concept of emotional intelligence. And people who are a student of the subject of emotional intelligence will know this already, that emotional intelligence always tells you to distrust your first instinct, right? If your first instinct is of anger, then don't trust your anger. Yeah. The moment you distrust your first instinct, you would find yourself more focused into the subject rather than what you're feeling about it at the first go, right? So distrust your first instinct because it can lead you to make certain wrong decisions, okay? You can always rely back on your first instinct later on if you think that your first instinct, your second instinct, your third instinct, your fourth instinct, everything is pointing towards the same direction, then it's fine. But the immediately when you engage with someone and either you get super excited or very angry, that's not good, right? So try to distrust your first instinct. It will help you to remain focused on your mission of providing a well-rounded constructive feedback. Disagreement is your first opportunity to sometimes correct yourself. If any mistakes are on your end, emphatically admit your mistakes openly. Once again, a tip and trick for disarming your opponent, in this case your reportee, who is not your opponent, but you're providing feedback to your reportee, so from that perspective he is your opponent, right? Because you're having a conversation. And so you're always looking for ways and means to disarm your opponent, so that you whenever you're delivering those critical observations, you want those critical observations to land in the right spot. And it also makes way for getting the feedback absorbed well. During disagreement, always look for areas of agreement and summarize them. There's also a very important part where we say that let the other person save face. Praise wholeheartedly at even the slightest of improvement seen. It increases the chances of improvement and repetition of good work done by the employee. Whenever an employee has committed a mistake, even before you provide a feedback, that employee already knows that he has committed a mistake. Most of the time, we know that we have done something wrong. Our inner conscience always talks to us, right? So we know we have done something wrong. And whenever our wrongdoing gets caught by someone, then a lot of us react different way. But majority of us, we try to put up our defense, right? We try to put reasons and excuses to save ourselves from that humiliation. When you talk about any mistake or any negative feedback, to an employee, and the employee tries to defend himself or herself by citing some reasons and excuses, right? The first one or two times that you see this, don't just try to corner the employee with more and more facts just to prove him wrong that all the things that you're trying to say is just excuses. Don't go that way, right? When an employee is trying to defend himself or herself, it's just a natural biological reaction of a human being to put up his defense, right? Because these days, people are very scared of getting punished for their mistakes or losing their job or getting a warning letter. People are very scared of the job because the job market is such a way that the leaders and CEOs who lead the organization does not lead people with empathy. Right. So even with slightest of mistake, they're okay to terminate an employee. So people are always scared. And whenever they think they have committed a mistake and that mistake has been noticed by especially manager, they always would try to put up some excuses and reasons and defenses. I'm not saying that always entertain those, but for the first one or two sessions where an employee is trying to put up some defense, try to give the employee few more chances to improve on his behavior. Buy into those excuses intentionally. Don't just try to prove the employee wrong, even if you can prove the employee wrong. Don't go that way. Let the employee save his face. Intention is to make the employee realize that somebody has noticed your mistake. And the employee would know that, okay, this time I got saved. This time I was able to put some excuses and I was saved. But if it is next time, then the same excuses will not run. And even if the employee provides an excuse next time, you might want to consider that as well. But do understand that you are the same employee, you are the same human being who are giving reasons of excuses and mistakes. With every reasons or excuses you are providing to your manager, you know that your life is getting short. So there's only two ways. One is, if you cannot change, if you think that you will continue doing this, then you have to leave the organization. And if that happens, you may be saved. You as an employer can be saved because you are safe from an employee who could have potentially be a risk to your business, right? He could have leaked out a sensitive information to your customer, right? So it can be a potential threat to your business. But if it is the other way around, if the employee is actually a trying guy, right, actually a person who committed mistake and he realized and he appreciates the empathy shown by his or her manager, when he would try to put in his genuine effort to improve, just imagine how much respect he will have for you as a manager, right? Because you as a manager gave him a chance, did not misunderstood him, right? So always let the person save the face for at least for some time. Do not take for granted your star performers. They are the people who deserve feedbacks too. While giving feedback to stars, praise wholeheartedly and do not hold back. Tell them specifically which characteristics of them are liked by you and why they are also so valuable. Do not let the feedback end only with praise. As I said before, that your star performers might be requiring minimum feedback or minimum coaching from you because that's why they're star, right? They're a role model. However, they will cease to become star or they will not be with you or with your organization if you fail to provide them the appropriate challenges that can stimulate them. Give them the next challenge, which is an area of their improvement. The next one is seeking feedback. We spoke about how to provide feedback. Now it's time to seek feedback. This is an important aspect of management that at least in 21st century, it has its relevance. And all you first-time managers and people who want to become managers in the coming years, this would be one important aspect of your leadership and management career, seeking feedback. Feedback is a two-way communication. So encourage team members also to provide you feedback as well. Not too long back, I think these days also, in my times, we used to have something which we used to say HR skip level meeting. It's basically called a skip feedback or HR level skip feedback. Typically, it happens when maybe quarterly or semester wise or yearly wise, your HR or your manager's boss or maybe the head of the department will come to you. They will tell your manager to wait outside the room and they will try to talk to you and they will try to spy on your manager, kind of try to get a straight feedback from you on how good or bad your manager is so that employees can open up, and if your manager is not good, they can speak up. But the intention of the skip feedback is to understand how managers are working, right? Whether the employees are getting feedback, whether employees are happy with the manager or not. That's basically the intention of the skip level feedback. But the issue that I find with skip level feedback is trust. Through the skip level feedback, are you elevating the trust between the manager and his manager? Are you elevating the trust or are you beating the trust down, right? I think you are beating the trust down, because if I'm a manager and if my manager does not trust me that I'm doing a good job with my team member and he jumps over the top of my head and reaches directly to my team member to ask how am I managing them, then do I feel trusted by my manager? No, right? So it does not do any good to the trust. Even if it is an HR, it still does not talk about trust, right? So I think the best way that I have found myself, that is to go to the employees directly that you manage and ask them for a feedback. Now, it might happen that, since you are a manager, a lot of employee might not open up, thinking that if they say something bad about you or criticize you, then you might take a kind of revenge back on them, right? Or maybe use certain organization policies and procedures against that particular employee, maybe not promote him or maybe not provide him a proper increment. Thinking about those things, an employee might not open up. And it is true. Yeah, I'm not impractical, so it is true. However, when you vet the pros and cons of this self-feedback, the pros are much more heavier than the cons. And the pros are, increased trust between you and your reportees, increased openness. Of course, the first time the employee might not open up, but when you conduct these self-seeking feedback again and again, month on month, year on year, when you conduct that, maybe one person out of your team, and of course you have to walk the talk, right? So it will give some courage to one person out of your team to maybe one day say, can I tell you something? I do see that on Friday, you leave office early, and that kind of puts us into a bit of trouble because those customer who ask for you in the later part of the day, we are unable to transfer this customer to you, and we have to manage this customer all by ourselves, and I think that's not helping our customer. Yeah. So maybe one employee one fine day speak up against you, right? The moment you hear something negative about you, some criticism about you, emphatically admit your mistake, if it is a mistake. Yeah, if it is a mistake, if you think that actually that's the correct thing, emphatically admit your mistakes, make that employee stand up and appreciate that employee that he did talk about certain things which is not happening right. Yeah, and then work on that yourself. Your people must see you going through that same drill that you preach and teach every day. If you just talk about integrity, if you just talk about honesty, if you talk about punctuality, all those talks that you do, all those pep talks or motivational talks that you do, actually does not land in the right spot, because a lot of you might not be walking the talk. When you walk the talk, inspiration starts from there. You know, when employee see that you're talking the right things and you're also walking the talk, right? If you're just talking the right things but you're not walking the talk, there's no inspiration, right? So inspiration starts there. So whenever you find even one employee talking against you, praise that employee for being so candid with you. Thank the employee for letting you know that you have a blind spot, and you know, tell the employee that you will work on that and try to better yourself on that, right? And genuinely work towards that. And when you do that, other employees get the courage to speak up against you. And the more, more and more employee will talk against you and, you know, criticize you and, you know, see certain areas of improvements in you, this would be your opportunity to understand your weak areas, rather than your manager, your HR coming to you and saying that you need to improve on this. By doing this exercise, you would already know what are your areas of improvement. What are the things that employees are looking for you but not getting from you? That is benefit number one. Benefit number two, increase trust. Just understand how much trust you are developing within the team, that your manager is open to criticism. If our manager is open to his own criticism from us, then who are we to not be open to criticism when he provides a feedback to us? Think about the larger impact it will have on your employees, right? And you might not have to remember an employee all these tips and tricks of providing feedback. Through this self-seeking feedback mechanism, you might be able to inspire your entire team, and providing feedback, positive or negative, might become so easy that your employee would be almost reading you even before you provide the feedback. Yeah, so encourage your team member to provide you feedback as well. This way, you will develop your weak areas and become a very strong leader. On the other hand, you will also promote employee engagement and make your feedback sessions more effective, since an employee will open up in a very clean system and receive feedbacks well. Last but not the least, create a feedback loop. As I said, and just to summarize, feedback is all about an observation. And once you observe, you provide the feedback. Once you provide the feedback, you take action in form of you document the feedback and you set up an action plan for the employee. And once you do that, you have to follow up on the employee whether the things that we agreed on were being actioned. So you have to set up follow-up meeting, maybe on the next month or the next week, whatever you desire. Once you follow up, once again you start observing whether it's being actioned on. Once again you provide feedback, then action, then follow-up. And the cycle goes again and again and again and again. It gets repeated. So this is what we call a feedback loop. And it's important that in your team or in your group or in your organization, you create this feedback loop, and you create this feedback loop in a constructive way, positive way, and you keep following it. Yeah, it might be a very boring, monotonous routine that you might have to do, a kind of a drill that you do have to do every single day, just like brushing your teeth. But creating a feedback loop would be a very essential element of your feedback mechanism. So I hope you guys like the content, and hope you guys made a few notes wherever you think you would be applying that immediately or in future. Once again, I have told it many times, it's more important to walk the talk rather than talking the right things, right? So we are right now training and talking the right things. The challenge of management and leadership is how you walk the talk, how you practice what you learn. I'll see you in the next video. Till that time, you take care and stay healthy.